area. In fact, the minimum wages bill came to be passed on the basis of the ILO conference in 1928, as early as 1928, and which perhaps motivated the then provincial government to form a labor committee. That was in 1946, to enact a separate enactment for labor, the minimum wages legislation. And the minimum wages bill, which came to be formulated as early as April 1946, but it was come into force only from 15-3-1948. This is the brief background of the minimum wages law. Now, the Committee of Fair Wages, which the Committee of Fair Wages contemplated three different types of wage structure. One is the minimum wages, which represented the bare sustenance and perhaps is comparable to the poverty level, just above poverty level. The next one would be the fair wages, which is considered above the minimum wages, but less than the living wages. Now, the Committee on Fair Wages observed that the bottom part of the fair wages would be obviously the minimum wages. Now, the living wages, the next one is the living wages. Living wages is a comfort level wages, where the capacity of the industry is taken into consideration, where apart from the bare essentials, provisions are made for housing, education, other requirements and social needs. Now, insofar as the judiciary is concerned, as early as 1961, 1 LLJ 339, Express Newspapers Limited case, they had analyzed the concept of minimum wages, fair wages, and living wages. And this was a case where the wage board of the working journalists, as well as the provision which contemplated constitution of working wage board, was challenged by the various newspaper establishment before the Supreme Court, and which came to Supreme Court, and Supreme Court had an occasion to deal with all the three concepts, and which was also subsequently followed in various decisions. I'm just, for example, highlighting one more decision, which is in Standard Vacuum case, which also followed Express newspaper case, which is reported in AR 1961, Supreme Court 895. Now, this is insofar as the wages are concerned. Now, coming to the specifics of the Minimum Wages Act itself, now, if you will see two important aspects. Now, one is relating to the appropriate government. Now, the appropriate government, unlike the Industrial Disputes Act, slightly takes a slight deviation. Now, insofar as the appropriate government relating to the center, where the central government is the appropriate government, it relates to only a mine, oil field, port, or a corporation established by a central act, or a schedule of employment carried on by an authority of the central government. Now, in all other cases, the scheduled employment becomes the state government. Now, in which case, insofar as the minimum wages is concerned, if you will see, the role of the central government is very limited, and substantial flexibility is given to the state government to fix their own minimum wages in respect of any scheduled employment, including the various employments in the schedule. Now, Section 3(2) of the Act is contemplates as to how a minimum wage is to be fixed. Of course, most of you would be familiar with all these provisions. I thought, since I am starting with the minimum wages, I thought I should also give a brief background with regard to the enactment, so that people who are not familiar would also be familiar, would also get enlightened by this. Now, coming back to Section 3(2), minimum wages is time rate or piece rate, and Section 4(1) contemplates as to how, what are the components relating to the Minimum Wages Act. Section 4(1) talks of basic wages and a special allowance, which is in variance with the cost of living index. If you will see, Section 4(1) is not akin to dearness allowance. It talks of a special allowance. Section 4(2) contemplates basic wages with or without cost of living allowance and cash value of essential commodities as concessional rates. Now, if you will see, most of the minimum wages notifications are fixed based on the powers exercised under Section 4(2), except very few instances where Section 4(3), I will again go to 4(3). Section 4(3) contemplates an all-inclusive basic wage, cost of living, and value of essential commodities. Now, Section 4(3), except if you see agriculture as an industry, all other industries relate to Section 4(2), where there is a basic wage with cost of living index and value of essential commodities wherever it is available. Now, there are two procedures which is contemplated for fixing minimum wages. The first method would be to appointment of a committee and subcommittee, where employers and the unions representing the workmen are forming part of the committee, along with the various government officials, and who take data from the various industries, and who arrive at, based on the data available, based on the data and feedback which is made to them, given to them, fix the minimum wages for that scheduled industry. Now, the second methodology, which is contemplated in Section 5, is by a notification in the Official Gazette calling for proposals for objections. And this is again, most of the minimum wages is again fixed on the basis of Section 5(2), where notification is giving draft notifications are published in the Gazette, inviting proposals and objections from the various employers as well as the unions, and that is taken into consideration. That is expected to be taken into consideration. How far they take into consideration is always a question of debate. And a final notification is issued. Now, if you see, the concept of dearness allowance is based on the powers vested, as I told you, under Section 4. Now, dearness allowance is essentially an allowance which contemplates the taking into account the various increases or decreases in the value of the cost of living, which is reckoned and which is supposed to be taken into account while giving the increases to the workmen. Now, the cost of dearness allowance, insofar as dearness allowance is concerned, now there are various factors. The first one is the cost of food. Food, cereals, pulses, oils, meat, fish, any vegetables, fruits, all these things are forming part of cost of food. That is one of the factor which is taken into account. The second one is, interestingly, pan, supari, tobacco, and intoxicants also are taken into account for the purpose of fixing cost of living index. The third one is fuel and light. Fourth is housing. Fifth is clothing, bedding, and footwear. Sixth, medical care. Seventh, education, recreation, and amusement. Eighth, transportation and communication. Ninth, personal care and personal effects. And also other miscellaneous items. Now, all these, the cost of all these ingredients are taken into account for the fixing of cost of living. Now, insofar as the cost of living indexing itself, in India, there are three basic years of index. The first one is 1960, which is 100. 1982 base year, that is again, and 2001. Now, 1982 index, insofar as introduction of minimum wages is concerned, and insofar as adopting it for various minimum wages notifications, it started sometime in 1989. And 2001, the index was introduced sometime in 2006. Now, coming back to, as I told you earlier, the cost of food and other ingredients make up. Now, the one puzzling thing which people may wonder, what exactly is cost of living? Now, when I say indexing it at 1960, now, all the costs which I have mentioned earlier is equivalent to 100. That is the basis points for treating the indexing points. Now, any increase from that indexing points is reckoned every month. And that is taken into account, and that is factored into the index, the average index. All the costs of whatever I have told you earlier is averaged into an index of 100, which means 1960, the average index will be 100. January 1961, perhaps it will be 101. I'm just giving you an example. It may be 102 for the February. It will be 103 for March. It may be again coming back to 100 in April. So the price and rise and fall of the various foodstuff and various other amenities, which is contemplated under the items whichever I told you earlier, is reckoned. Cost of food and other items are reckoned, and on that index is factored. Now, in so far as the calculation is typically done by the statistics department of the government of India, as well as by the government of Tamil Nadu. Which today mostly it was all only done by the Labor Bureau statistics, the Labor Bureau, and which calculate the index every month and releases the cost of living index for not only the various the center but also the various towns, including cities. Now in Tamil Nadu, you have got the cost of living index, which is notified for Chennai, Coimbatore, Madurai, Trichy, Nagarkoil. Every town they collect the data and release the cost of living. And in some cases they follow various cost of living points. Now increases, insofar as increases are concerned, the dearness allowance, though the notification of the increases in cost of living is given on a month-on-month basis, the increases generally are either once in a quarter, once in half year, or annual. Very few cases, yes, there are instances where monthly increases in cost of living also is granted, insofar as minimum wages notifications are concerned. I'll come to that specifics later. Now, the next aspect is neutralization. Now, I had dealt with earlier with regard to the cost of living, 100 points, 1960. Likewise, 1982, 100 points. Likewise, 2001, 100 points. Now, increases are granted. Now, as and when minimum wages are notified or revised, a portion of the basic wages is increased, and that factors into some portion of the increase which has already been granted as dearness allowance. So in order to neutralize that, what the government does is, up to a particular point, though 2001 it is 100, up to a certain point they will say there is no increase or decrease in so far as dearness allowance is concerned, and beyond that point alone the employer will be obliged to pay increase per point as per the notification. Now for example, in 2001 the common denominator denominating cost of living neutralizing point is 161. Now up to 161, it is presumed that the basic wages which has been granted to the individual workman itself takes care of the cost of living, and beyond 161 alone any variance in dearness allowance is factored into, and the increase in dearness allowance guaranteed to the individual employee based on the notification in respect of the scheduled employment. Now, if you see neutralization in so far as 2001 is concerned, it's typically 161. Now, in 1982, it was when 1982 notification, the cost of living was followed. The neutralizing factor was 475, and in 1960 when it was followed it was 808. Now why the various neutralizing factors are once again revised from time to time is because over a period of time, let us say today if you were to take 1960 base, even per month the number of points increase will be very huge, and it is in this context the government from time to time has revised the cost of living index itself and adopted a new cost of living index to ensure that there is some amount of smoothness without any rough edge. And the next aspect is with regard to working of the dearness allowance in respect of the various minimum wages notifications. Now, as I told you, most of the notifications follow an annual pattern in Tamil Nadu. However, in other states, it is every half year the increase in dearness allowance is granted. And taking into account the fact that the government statistics department has to release the DA points, and it takes some time for them to gather the data and then release the points. Now, the dearness allowance points are followed on a subsequent quarterly basis or a half yearly basis or an annual basis. For example, in so far as Tamil Nadu is concerned, as I told you, most of the industries which follow an annual increase in cost of living, they follow the increase of cost of living from January to December, which is effective from April to March. In other words, the average indices of January to December, increase in indices in the January to December is taken into account for the increase in dearness allowance from April of the subsequent following year to March of the subsequent year. Now, where it comes to half yearly, January to June is followed from October to March, and July to December is followed from April to September. So this is how, and likewise quarterly also, that's how it has been followed. In very few cases, for example, footwear and leather goods, these are two exceptions where on a month-on-month basis they calculate dearness allowance on the latest available cost of living. Now, one more aspect which I thought I should bring it to your notice is that most of the notifications in Tamil Nadu follow the average indices of Chennai cost of living, as opposed to they don't region. For example, even a industry which is based out of Kanchipuram or perhaps deep down south, Madurai, will still continue to follow the Chennai cost of living index for the purpose of compliance of minimum wages. The only exception which I find is with regard to cashew industry, where Nagarkoil index average is taken into account for the purpose of compliance of the minimum wages and also calculating the dearness allowance. And one more aspect which I thought I should also point out is, while most of the dearness allowance, most of the notifications are uniform with regard to dearness allowance applicable across all categories of people, whether it is manager, whether it is supervisor, whether it is workman, any category, it will the dearness allowance will be uniform for all categories. There is no differentiation, at least in Tamil Nadu is concerned. Now, plantation again draws an exception. In plantation, there's a differential DA fixed for adults and adolescents. That's the only notification where I find there is a differential DA fixed for both the two different class of people. Now, notifications, coming to the effectively coming to the notifications, and so far as notifications are concerned, notifications, the basic as I told you, there are two components insofar as the notifications is concerned. The only exception being the hotels and restaurants. In all the other instances, there will be only two components, namely basic and dearness allowance. Now, in some notifications, you will find the basic is calculated on a monthly basis. Basic is either calculated on a piece rate basis or basic is notified on a daily basis. So if you see, notifications differ from each in establishment or each industry to another. For example, in handloom, vessels, gold, silver and fireworks, all these notifications are on piece rate basis. And in some cases, it will be a basic, while the basic will be notified on a daily basis, the dearness allowance will be notified on a monthly basis. One of the popular examples which I can perhaps share with you is the notification pertaining to general engineering and fabrication industry, where the insofar as the workmen category are concerned, the notification for skilled, unskilled and semi-skilled is notified on a daily rate basis, whereas the dearness allowance is notified on a monthly basis. This perhaps gives rise to a confusion as to how one should take into account the monthly rate of wages. What should be the minimum wages calculatable for the particular category? Now, there also the notification itself provides a solution. Now, most of the notifications specify this clause: to arrive at a daily rate of wages, the monthly wages shall be divided by 26. And to arrive at a monthly rate of wages, the daily wages shall be multiplied by 30. This is a common feature in most of the notifications notified in Tamil Nadu. Now, coming back to the general engineering and fabrication industry, where the daily, insofar as the basic wages is concerned, the notification is made on a daily rate, whereas the dearness allowance is notified on a monthly rate. Now, if I am to pay an unskilled employee on a monthly rate, what am I to do? How do I calculate the minimum rate of wages? Now, a solution lies in the notification, as I told you. The daily rate of basic alone will have to be multiplied by 30 and added up to the monthly rate of dearness allowance in order to arrive at the minimum rate of wages payable to the employee. Now, let us understand an employer is employing a casual employee in the same general engineering and fabrication industry. Now, how do I arrive at a daily rate for him? Now, daily rate of minimum wages, basic wages is already specified in the notification. That is taken, and the dearness allowance alone is divided by 26 in order to arrive at the daily dearness allowance for the individual, and that added together will form part of the daily wages of the employee. Now, in fact, one of the interesting cases which I had come across on this aspect was that a group of employees had joined together, had made a claim for differential claim for minimum wages. What they did was, where the notification both in respect of the basic and dearness allowance was monthly, they divided it by 26, again multiplied it by 30, and made a claim saying that this is the differential minimum wages I am supposed to get. Now, it was a very interesting point, which, of course, one of my colleagues had handled the case. The labor court very strangely allowed the minimum wages claims, which I, in my respectful view, was wrong, because the concept of dividing, it is on, for you to arrive at a daily rate where it's a casual employee alone, is you are required to divide by 26, and it is not with a view to arrive at already where you are paying monthly wages, and monthly rate of wages already been notified and you are paying monthly rate of wages. It is not, you are not supposed to divide it by 26 again multiplied by 30. And that's a very wrong approach. Anyway, that is one of the instances where I thought I could perhaps share with you. Now, the second aspect is that this again is a very common feature in most of the notifications, in fact, almost all the notifications. It says wherever the existing wages are higher than the minimum rates fixed, the same higher wages shall continue to be paid. Now, here, this gives rise to a lot of questions. Now, I have got there may be a company which may be paying basic wages, dearness allowance, HRA, conveyance, all put together would be more than the minimum wages, but basic wages and dearness allowance will be less than the minimum rate of wages notified by the government. Now, what am I to do? Now, the answer lies in the definition of the minimum wage, the minimum wages, definition of wages under the Minimum Wages Act. As you will see, wages has been defined to include all remuneration which is capable or expressed in terms of money, in terms of contract employment, and includes house rent allowance. Only exceptions being value of house accommodation, supply of light, water, medical attendance, any amenity or any service excluded by its general order, any contribution paid to provident fund, any traveling allowance or value of traveling concession. In other words, if the conveyance allowance is in the nature of a reimbursement, that certainly could not be taken into account for the purpose of complying with the minimum wages law. Now, any sum paid to the employee to defray expenses in the nature of his employment. For example, most of these establishments would pay washing allowance. Now, that certainly cannot be reckoned into account for the purpose of compliance of minimum wages, because that is in the nature of reimbursement for maintenance of his uniform. And that would form within the exclusion to defray special expenses. Whether the employer is obliged to pay dearness allowance, notwithstanding the fact that his pay package does not have a dearness allowance as one of the components in his wage packet, came up for consideration in one of the judgments, which most of you will be aware, AR 1999 Supreme Court 2459, Air Freight's case. So this continues to be the leading position insofar as payment of dearness allowance is concerned, where the Supreme Court says, where the lump sum wages exceeds the minimum wages notified, then the question of making a demand for a separate dearness allowance does not arise. This was a case where Air Freight was called upon to pay dearness allowance separately, notwithstanding the fact the total wages, sum total of wages they didn't have a dearness allowance in their pay packet, and notwithstanding that, the labor inspector said that the employer is obliged to pay dearness allowance separately, and he issued a notice. That came to be challenged, and this matter went up to Supreme Court, and Supreme Court said no. Where the wages, some total of wages, exceeds the wages prescribed under the Minimum Wages Act, the question of separate payment of dearness allowance would not arise. Another case which had come up very recently, and which is of certainly of interest, is reported in 2019 7 scale 39. This is relating to Hindustan sanitary ware, which came up from the out of UP notification, I think, if I'm right. The notification under that it came out of Haryana. It came out of a Haryana notification, which interestingly, among the other things, the notification itself said that you cannot the minimum wages rates of wages cannot be permitted to be segregated into various forms of allowances by the employer. In other words, the notification itself prohibited, made an embargo upon the employer to segregate the minimum rates of wages into various allowances. Another aspect which was also which interesting feature in that notification was that the notification contemplated that upon an unskilled employee, upon completion of a particular number of years, automatically becomes semi-skilled, and upon completion of a number of years as semi-skilled, automatically becomes a skilled employee. In fact, if I may read that, unskilled employees having 5 years of experience would be deemed to be categorized as semi-skilled A. After 3 years of experience in semi-skilled A, the employees would be categorized as semi-skilled B. Now, both these provisions came to be challenged by the Hindustan Sanitary Ware before the Supreme Court. Matter went up to Supreme Court, and Supreme Court said, insofar as the embargo of the employer, the right of the employer to divide the wages into various allowances, the court said, sorry, that could not be done, and that was held to be bad. Equally, the court also said that insofar as the automatic upgradation of the employee from semi-skilled to unskilled and unskilled to skilled, etc., that also was held to be bad on the ground that the right of promotion of an employee rests with the employer, and it would the government cannot impose itself upon by introducing a notification whereby the promotion gets automatic. The second aspect, as I told you earlier, insofar as the notification relating to embargo, they had specifically referred to the section which defines wages and said that wages is a wide definition, and so long as the employer is paying wages, the sum total of wages as defined under the Minimum Wages Act, he is perfectly in order. And that's what the Supreme Court observed. Why I thought this case is a very interesting case is because if you see the Tamil Nadu notification again with regard to the general engineering and fabrication industry, you will find a similar provision in the note. If I may read it, just a minute. Where semi-skilled with a particular number of years is automatically treated as skilled, likewise unskilled with an having a service of so many years would automatically become semi-skilled and so on and so forth. If you see the skilled definition, persons having experience of a period of 5 years in a particular trade, or persons who possess a trade certificate including industrial in ITI certificate for a period of 3 years in a particular trade. So the moment he has 5 years experience, he is treated to be skilled. Likewise, semi-skilled also, persons who has worked as helpers for not less than 2 years in a particular trade is automatically treated as semi-skilled. And unskilled, of course, the definition is person who do not require any training. So perhaps a similar, I would perhaps say that on the similar lines, this is being done. And which is since been set aside by Supreme Court, perhaps in a given case, in so far as general engineering fabrication industry's notification also is concerned, I do believe that this may be not proper for the government to have exercised its option to automatically promote or grant promotion from unskilled labor to semi-skilled labor just by the number. Having the number of years of experience into account. With that, I would perhaps one more aspect which I thought I should also add is with regard to Section 15. Section 15 of the Minimum Wages Act contemplates that where the employee works for less than the normal working day, if you see, the Minimum Wages Act contemplates what constitutes a normal working day and what constitutes a normal week and so on and so forth. Oh, which is 8 hours. Oh, even if he works for less than the normal working day, he is entitled to the wages as notified under the Minimum Wages Act. Oh, difficulty would be insofar as people who are engaged just for about 1 hour or 2 hours. In my respectful view, in those cases where the employee is employed by the industrial establishment, notwithstanding the fact that the individual is employed just for 1 hour or 2 hours, if the rate of wages notified is on a time rate basis, then he is entitled to wages for the day, and you cannot treat the employee as having worked only for 2 hours. Because his nature of work is such that his nature, the work itself lasts only for 2 hours. With that, I would perhaps conclude, and if there is any questions which I can take, I'd be glad.
Thank you, sir. And we have time for the questions. And the participants, if you are willing to put some questions to Mr. Sahib Prasad, and he'd be able to respond. You can raise your hands, wave your hands so far as the screen is concerned. I'll unmute you. You can post the question to Mr. Sahib Prasad.
Yes, I think Mr. Rajaram is wanting to ask some questions.
Yes.
I you're not audible, Mr. Rajaram. Perhaps Harun, you might. Yeah.
I will.
Mr. Rajaram.
Yeah, sir. Good morning, sir.
Morning.
Sir, I just want some clarification from you.
Yeah.
Suppose if I am entering a contract or settlement with the union, and I am paying more than the amount as fixed in the minimum wages.
Yeah.
That contract is valid under the Minimum Wages Act or not?
Certainly, yes. So long as the wages, which is some total of wages, which is which you are paying to the workman, is more than the minimum wages, there is no bar. That's why I had referred to the specific provision, which says that where the wages is paid more, where the you may not find it in the book, Mr. Raja.
Yeah.
You may have to find refer to the various notifications, which will specifically say that wherever the existing wages are higher, the same shall be continued to be paid. And since you are paying more than the minimum wages, there is no difficulty in so far as compliance of minimum wages is concerned.
Sorry, suppose I am segregating the minimum wages as allowances, you know, and it is coming to more than the amount fixed tax under the Minimum Wages Act, whether it is valid?
Now, to answer the question, perhaps I would perhaps slightly put it to you differently. Your basic and dearness allowance would be less than the minimum wages, but taking into account the allowances, it would be more than the minimum wages. That is your question, right?
Yes, yes.
Now,
yes.
In fact, that is the insofar as that is concerned, your question has been answered by the decision of
judgment by 2019 and judgment.
Yes. Therefore,
there won't
be any difficulty. But then please ensure that the allowances so paid are not in the nature of reimbursements, but in the nature of allowances. See, the test perhaps would be, ideal test which I would perhaps say is that, suppose if the employee is on leave, what are the components that the employer would take for the purpose of reckoning his wage leave? If those components are taken into account, and if you and if those components put together are more than the minimum wage notification, then you are in safe hands.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Rajagopalan. Good morning.
Yeah. Good morning. So I share with you that in some cases they divide the dearness allowance, which is paid monthly, by 26 and making the compliance. How much you are able to explain with an example? It is the contracted amount, but this way, if you calculate it much more than the contracted amount, that does not seem to be so easily agree. I also agree with you that we need to touch similar situations in the Minimum Wage Authority, number one. Secondly, now, after the Hindustan Sanitary Ware case,
yes.
So rightly pointed out, I am glad that about the Minimum Wage Notification, General Engineering, so automatic promotion every 3 years, that is also same. Certain unions are making up. They decide the promotion and all that. That is not correct.
Right.
But still, can you not, after this 2019 sanitary war case, Hindustan sanitary, can you not challenge the government?
Certainly, notification is certainly
you
open to
be
challenge.
Trying, you know?
Perhaps a painful employer, perhaps may be willing to challenge it, and you may have to choose who is willing to challenge it.
No,
in my view. In the light of Hindustan Sanitary Ware, the notification of General Engineering, which specifies that the number of years automatically he goes into semi-skill, may held to be bad.
Bad, yes. So we can go instead of individual organization, the employer
certainly,
can take up the issue,
certainly.
The government order.
Certainly, sir.
So nice participating with you. That. I regard your father.
Certainly. Thank you. I will convey it to
you. Sir, I'm Sai Prasad. One of the participants is Mr. Ravindran, senior advocate.
Oh.
And he can also say something. Sir, Mr. Ravi, sir, if you want to say something. Hello. Ravindran sir, are you able to hear me?
In the meanwhile, I thought Mr. Karthik
yes.
had raised a question. I think.
Yes.
Chat. With regard to general engineering and fabrication industry being covering almost all industries, which is not notified.
Yes.
In my view, that may not be entirely correct, because there may certainly be industries. For example, let us understand an industry which has a small portion of its activity as a lathe functioning, and predominant product is something else, and the predominant operation is something else. Certainly, you can't say that the minimum wages pertaining to general engineering fabrication industry would apply to every instance in the country. In fact, Supreme Court had also an occasion to deal with this. Where they have observed that it is not it's not as if that every industry you can apply. You will have to have the test of what is the predominant nature of work in that industry.
Sir, Sai sir.
Yeah.
Can you say something about the DNS allowance which is being now started by the government of Tamil Nadu? Is it same as like the private establishments, or what is the significance?
So far as DNS allowance in Tamil Nadu government servants are concerned, perhaps the DNS allowance is calculated on an entirely different basis, Arun. They take it as a percentage of the basic. In fact, such kind of notifications is also not alien to minimum wages notification. In fact, interestingly, in one of the notifications, I find that a similar pattern is also adopted. Handloom weaving, if you take handloom weaving notification, DNS allowance, the basic pay is actually based on the quantity which has been produced by the individual. It is piece rate basis. Now, it is either on a per dozen or per unit or per meter or per feet or so on and so forth. A whole lot of items are there, depending on the item. The DNS allowance there is 10% of the basic. For example, if I produce 100 units and I get a basic of so much, and that will be my DNS allowance for that particular day will be 10% of the basic which I earn for the day. So that is the only place where I find that in Tamil Nadu there's an exception where the percentage of the basic is taken as DNS allowance.
Thank you, sir. Any questions from anyone else?
Yes, one more.
Mr. Rajaram.
Yes, Mr. Rajaram. I think you'll have to unmute him.
Mr. Rajaram, can you?
Yes, Mr. Rajaram, you can proceed.
Yes. What is the difference between DA and VDA, sir?
Insofar as DA is concerned, now there are two concepts of DA. One is a fixed DNS allowance. Some companies adopt the payment of fixed DNS allowance, which also takes into account the DNS allowance which is already granted to them in the past, and which is fixed. And the variable DNS allowance is on the basis of the rise or increase and decrease in cost of living.
Mr. Rajagopalan wants. Yes, sir. The fixed DA is neutralized to certain points.
Yes, correct.
And variable DA over and above those points on the contract date.
Correct. In fact, I told you, when notifications are revised,
the total component of the portion
of the variable DNS allowance gets merged into the fixed, the basic wages, and that forms part of the in so far as in no base no, minimum wages notifications are concerned, there is no concept of a fixed DO.
And then you have rightly pointed out, sir, that with regard to the section 15, because I am available for 8 hours, but you are only using me for 2 hours.
Exactly.
Therefore, I am entitled to 8 days wages.
Yes.
Correct.
Correct.
But now you are given a nice suggestion. Don't fix in such cases. Don't fix a daily rate. Fix an hourly rate. 8 hours wages divided by 1 hour.
That is not my suggestion, sir. But then that may not be legal. I will tell you why. You have an issue with regard to that.
Because in case of domestic servants and all that, the situations arise. You know, they are also coming up for notification.
No. Domestic. In fact, as you said, domestic servants. If you see the notification relating to domestic servants, the notification contemplates three types. One is for a job. Second is per hour basis.
Yeah.
Third is per day basis. Fourth is per month basis.
Correct.
So all the four notifications are notified. So if you are employing a domestic servant just for 2 hours, you can take use of that notification, which notifies only for 2 hours.
That similarly, we can we not adopt the same formula? Then we engage certain.
Unfortunately, sir, the difficulty is in so far as those cases are concerned, the notification is not specifying per hour wages. All these notifications are either per day basis or per month basis. In fact, I can also share with you one of my clients' concerns with regard to this issue in salt industry. I'm sure you may also have faced this query. Salt industry typically works just about 2 or 3 hours in a day. Because of the nature of work, veyil jaasti aipochunaka vela manukku. Therefore, they work for 3 hours in a day, and notice was issued to one of my clients questioning, saying that you are paying less than the minimum wages. How the clients came to me, I said, you have no option in the light of section 15. Now they have questioned the very notification itself.
Yeah.
So we'll have to see how things go by. These are certain things which we'll have to possibly.
What is the stage of that the challenge and the notification?
It is pending before the court.
Okay.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you, sir. In fact, Mr. Rajagopal sir will be very happy to have this session, because one of his best subject is DNS allowance and minimum wages. So he'll be very interested to post many questions, but want of time, we are closing it. Sir, thank you, sir.
Before closing it, I just wanted to add that.
Yes, sir.
The Karthik asked a query, right?
Query, yes.
With regard to minimum wages. That is answered in the decision of Lingagowda Security.
Mysore Kirloskar.
Supreme Court 1967.
Yes, sir. Sir, thank you.
Where the Supreme Court has specifically observed that does the employment in stone breaking or stone crushing operations in mines specified and so on. So, amount to stone breaking or stone crushing, because stone breaking and stone crushing in mines is different from per se, so stone breaking and stone crushing, right? So they have said that it cannot happen that way. So you will have to look at it from the holistic perspective.
Thank you, sir. It was a very wonderful session. In fact, I didn't know that the paan and supari will be taken into account to calculate the cost of living. Fortunately, alcohol is not taken into account, because
no, it is. It says beverages.
Beverages.
So okay. I would not add beyond that.
Beverages. So
what is what's the constitution of the beverages? I don't know. Sorry.
Yes.
Intoxicant.
These. No, yes. Sorry. These. No. these various factors,
sukari, tobacco and intoxicants, not beverages,
intoxicants, these factors are goes into decide what is the cost of living, which I don't know all along, and it is very illuminating and in fact an interesting session we had with you, and we thank you for the for explaining the facets of DNS relevance and other aspects, and we look forward to hear you more from you, sir, and on this aspect, and this COVID-19 has brought us all together. Thank you to the participants. We'll have a session tomorrow as
brought together on a different platform.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah,
we'll have another session tomorrow, and we'll be notifying you all with regard. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Harun. Thanks for coordinating this. Thank you.
Yes.